So let me start. So we have been discussing the transformation laws of various fields, okay, in various representations. So today we'll begin by discussing the transformation laws of the gauge fields themselves, okay, in particular the field strengths. So remember that I introduced GMU. We can also think of this as if we define G mu nu as G mu nu T A, then G mu nu is this was the definition of the field strength. And then we found that the transformation law of G prime, okay, so first of all, transformation law of G prime is just U G U equals. Okay, it doesn't have the derivative kind of terms, okay, but the precise idea of defining this G was so that the derivative terms cancel. So this was the transformation law of G. And this we could write also in the component form as RAB of X G E mu nu, where RAB was defined by using U T A U inverse is equal to E B. And one of the purpose of defining this G mu nu was that we could write down the kinetic term as trace of G mu nu, right? Because that would be invariant because of this property of it. So the first thing we'll discuss today is the role of this RAB. We have been discussing various representations, okay, but we'll see that this RAB itself actually forms a representation. So let's we'll see what kind of representation it forms. So first let's check that it forms a representation. So for this we use the following fact. So how do we check that it forms a representation? That we first transform G by a gauge transformation U1 and then by U2, and that is supposed to be same as the gauge transformation generated by U1 U2, right? Because if you first apply U1 then U2, okay, then sorry, it should be the same as U2 U1, okay? So let's check that this is the case. So the defining relation for RAB is this one. In fact, now we can forget about G. We just want to check that this R forms a representation. Okay. How it came about, we don't care. This defines what this matrix RBA is. Okay, and we want to check that this forms a representation. So we just write this into steps. So first, we want to calculate U1, U2, TA. U1, U2, inverse. Okay? And I'll do this calculation in two ways. The first way is directly apply this formula for U1, U2. So this will be then PV R VA of Q1. Maybe I should have written this as R of Q. And this I should write as RAB of Q1. Okay, because the dependence on X of course comes through. So this is okay, right? I'm just using the fact that just this definition. But on the other hand, I can write this as U1, U2 TA, U2 inverse, U1 inverse. This one will be given by R TC R CA of U2. Okay, that again follows from this definition. So this I can write now as RCA of U2. Okay, these are of course as numbers. U1 TA, U1 inverse. Okay. And now this again I'll write following the same definition that is given here as TB. Sorry, this is TC. TB times R TC. So combining this, we get this is equal to TB times R DC of U1 RCA of U2. So now all you have to do is to compare these. Since these are linearly independent generators, right? If these two are equal, then that means the corresponding coefficients must also be equal. And so we get RVA of U1 U2 equal to R BC of U1 times RCA of U2. And so in the matrix notation, this tells us that R of U1 U2 to R of U1 and R of U2. So this is what we normally call the adjoint representation. So this shows that the field strength, okay, this object, GMU, always transforms in the adjoint representation. Okay, other fields may transform in various other representations, but the field strength always transforms in the adjoint representation of the gauge. So when you try to construct gauge invariant terms in the Lagrangian, okay, of the kind that we described yesterday we were describing scalar fields, but of course there is no reason why you have to construct only scalar fields. You could try to construct interactions involving the gauge fields as well, okay, through GMU. Okay. And there, when you combine and get an invariant quantity, you have to keep in mind that the field strength will transform in the adjoint representation. Okay, so the total thing, you have to make it into a singlet or a gauge invariant, taking this into account. Is this clear?
Those
will of course be separate, right? Those come from covariant derivatives, right? So there are some interaction terms which come simply from by replacing del mu by covariant derivative, right? That you cannot do anything about. Okay? But on top of that, you can add many interaction terms which are gauge invariant by themselves, right? So the rule is that you have to basically combine all the fields that you have, okay, in which you can also include the field strength, right, which transforms in the adjoint representation, and write down a term which is invariant under Gauss transformation and Lorentz transformation. Okay? Yesterday you didn't have to worry about Lorentz transformation because you are dealing with scalars. Right? But you can imagine that you combine the Gauss field with some derivatives of scalar fields. Right? So that the Lorentz indices are contracted, okay, and the gauge indices are appropriately contracted so as to form a singlet. Okay, gauge invariant quantity. So that's the general rule. Okay, when you try to construct any interaction term, any term in the action, you basically have to make sure that you contract all the Lorentz indices so that you get a Lorentz invariant quantity. And the gauge indices are contracted with an appropriate tensor, appropriate quantity, which makes it a singlet.
So here the field you use
d mu
instead of b mu.
Yes, because of b mu has this additional piece del mu u to u inverse, right?
Yes.
So because of this, it's hard to construct gauge invariant quantity with b mu. Okay. So the only place where b mu will ever appear explicitly is in the covariant derivatives. Right? There we saw that to make the covariant derivative in transform nicely, you have to introduce b mu. Okay, but that's the only way b mu will appear. Any other interaction term that you want to add, okay, should involve g mu, no? Okay. Unless it involves derivatives of fields, in which case b mu will enter through again the covariant derivatives. Okay. Suppose you want to couple f g mu nu, okay, with two derivatives of some other fields. Okay. So g mu nu has to be is this one, okay, and the derivatives of the other fields, which may be scalars, which are in some representation. Those have to be replaced by covariant derivatives. Okay? Because you first look at quantities which transform covariantly, which means it transforms as a matrix times that field or some combination of fields. And then you contract that indices appropriately using Clebsgordon coefficients so as to get a gauge invariant quantity. Is this clear? This is the general procedure. Okay? So when you try to write down the general interaction terms, we never include b mu by itself. Yeah, b mu will come only through covariant derivatives.
Sir, from that transformation, you T A inverse is equal to T V R B.
Yes.
So, if T A inverse encrossing.
Encrossing, yes.
So, then R B of T A also be encrossing.
Encrossing, yes. That's right.
So you cannot
increase
or reduce the dimension.
Well, see, the point is RBA is just number. Okay. So in fact, this is not a matrix. Okay. This UPA U inverse, okay, is a linear combination of the TBs. The matrix structure is here. Okay. These are just some numbers. Okay. So the matrix form of R comes from the fact that it carries this index A and B. Okay. So when I write R of U here, okay, this is the dimension of this is controlled by how many values A and B can take. Right? That in this case is n square minus 1. For SUN, for example, you saw n square minus 1 generators. Right? So that's the rule. It's not n by n, it's n square minus 1 times n square minus 1. Is this clear? So the adjoint representation always has the dimension which is equal to the number of generators of the two. Right, which in this case is n square minus 1. Right, these TAs are what are called generators of the group. Okay. There are n square minus 1 of them. Right, and that's what forms the index of the adjoint representation. Is this clear? So you have to think of this as an n square minus 1 times n square minus 1 matrix. When I write it this way. So now I'll discuss some more features of the gauge field strength. So since g mu nu, so g mu nu is a generator of the two, right? Because it's g mu nu to u. It's a linear combination of the two, yes? So this makes sense, Ra of g mu, g mu. Right? This by definition is just g mu nu, Ra of t. Is in any representation. Now, from this we can calculate what is area of G prime unit. Because G prime mu nu is U G mu nu U inverse. So using this we get this as R A of U. Sorry, R of U. R A of G mu nu. R of U. This uses one of the identities that we digested. So this says that if we consider this object, rays of RA of G mu RA. Okay, this time the traces over the dimension of the representation that is R represents. This is invariant. Right? By the same logic, RU and RU inverse just cancels from the two ends, okay, by the cyclic property of the trace. So this would suggest that we have a new candidate for the kinetic term. Right? Earlier we had taken trace of G mu nu G mu nu. Now we have trace of R A G mu nu R A G mu nu. So let's write it out a little more explicitly. It is still quadratic in G mu nu. So this is given by G and U nu, G B U nu, trace of R A of T A, R A. It's clear. I just took out G B U nu T A. I can take outside. Right. So earlier kinetic term was G mu nu G B mu nu trace T A T B. Okay. So the question is it possible to add this term in the action? This of course is gauge invariant. Okay. So it should be possible to add this term to the action. Okay. Now the reason that this is not, this doesn't give anything new, okay, is because what one can show is that this object that you have constructed here is actually proportional to trace of T A T B. Okay. I'll not give the proof here, but this is a simple group theory result, okay, that you will given two fields in the adjoint representation. Okay. There is only one way to make them into a singlet. Okay. That's what it is saying. This is an adjoint representation. This is an adjoint representation. And there is only one way to make this into a singlet, that's the general group theory result. Okay, and using that one can easily show that this should be proportional to trace T A T B. Okay. So you don't get anything new by considering this, because after all this trace G mu nu, you have this 1 over 2 G square trace T A T B G mu nu G mu nu, right? So if you add terms that are proportional to the same thing, okay, you can just add, absorb that into a redefinition of this coupling constant. So you don't get anything new by considering this. Okay. That is really a unique kinetic term for the gauge field that you can add. But this allows us to do something useful. And that is that because of this observation, okay, that you could have written down the gauge kinetic term in any representation, right? We didn't need the original TX to write down a gauge kinetic term, right? You could have written this in any representation. And similarly, we didn't really need the original size to introduce our gauge fields. The gauge fields transform in a certain way. So given any representation, you could write down the covariant derivatives, and the gauge fields appear in the covariant derivative in the standard fashion. So this observation allows us to generalize what we have done so far to any group. Groups for which there is no natural fundamental representation. So imagine that you have an exceptional group. You have studied ADE series in group theory, Dynkin diagrams, mathematical physics too. You had a course in mathematics, but the group theory was not taught. I see. Okay, so group theory, I am very surprised. Group theory was the main part of mathematics 2 course. I see, okay. Anyway, so the point is that there are groups for which there is no natural fundamental representation. Okay, those are called exceptional series. Okay. But what this tells us is it doesn't matter, okay, whether there is a natural fundamental representation or not. Okay, given any group, okay, you can think of the TAs as abstract generators, okay, with some commutation relation. Okay, TATB and commutator is given by I AFABC TC. Okay, given this, we can find representations of the algebra and call the corresponding group. Okay, so pick any representation. And based on that representation, we can construct a kinetic term. Okay, introduce this. So for every generator, you introduce this fields, G mu nu or B mu nu. Okay, you start with B mu nu. Okay, so basically, you don't think of the TAs as real physical matrices. Okay, some abstract objects. For every generator, okay, TA, you introduce B mu nu. Okay. Then you define your G mu nu. Okay, now of course these are not matrices, okay, but the other definition still makes sense. Okay, using this G mu nu as can construct a kinetic term by using this formula. Okay, pick any representation. Okay, once you have picked a representation, of course every generator is represented by matrix. Okay, you can construct this object and that gives a kinetic term for the gauge field. Okay. Similarly, take any field transforming some representation of that gauge group, of that group. Okay. Its covariant derivative can be defined by simply using the matrices that generators in that representation. You don't need the TAs by themselves, right? All you need is the R of TA, RA of TA or R of U, right? You could always work with some representation and represent the generators in that representation, the group elements in that representation, and everything that I have done so far can be done that way. Okay? So we started with the fundamental representation of SUN, okay, because it's just easier to visualize what that object is, but it's not necessary to pick any representation. Okay? You can do it in abstract terms. And whatever representation you use to define this kinetic term, you are guaranteed that different representations will just differ from each other by redefinition of this coupling constant, okay, which is an arbitrary constant anyway. Is this clear? Anyway, if you have not learned about exceptional groups, you should try to study it, because for particle physics, you may not need it. Okay, even in particle physics is quite often used. Okay. But if you want to go anywhere beyond standard model, you will probably need to know about exceptional groups. Okay, are there questions? Well, the point is, once you fix the trace TATB in the fundamental to be half, okay, then for different groups, the adjoint representation takes different values. Okay, it's not a universal number. Okay. But of course, the overall number depends on what you take to be the general normalization of TA. Okay. But once you have fixed the normalization of TA, then everything is fixed. Okay, so you have to normalize it in one particular representation. Okay, we have been taking it as a fundamental representation. We take trace TATB as half delta IB. But of course, you cannot do it for exceptional groups, right? Because there is a natural fundamental representation. You normalize it, say, in the adjoint representation. See, if you want to be universal, you can say that you will always work with adjoint representation. Right? In that case, you take that as your normalization, the standard convention. You define the generators, okay, all the normalization constants in that representation. And then the normalization in the other representations will be automatically determined. Okay, but that varies from group to group.
So, so far, whatever the identities have been proved, it cannot be shown that representation of this TATV follow the same algebra, I mean, with the same structure constant is.
Well, yes, you can prove it. Maybe I'll leave it as an exercise. Okay. So, exercise. Prove that RA of TA structure constant of course appear in the definition of G, right? Yes, I mean, this will be automatically used in the various manipulations that we'll be doing in time. Okay. So the way to prove this, maybe I can just say how to do this. So you take two elements, right? You want two infinitesimal elements. One is, say, 1 minus I epsilon A T A. Take another element U2, which is, let me write it, epsilon omega ATA, U2, which is 1 minus I eta n ATA, n ATA. Okay? Epsilon and eta are infinitesimal. Epsilon, eta, these are infinitesimal. Then you use the fact that R of U1, U2, U1 inverse, U2 inverse is R of U1, R of U2, R of U1 inverse, R of U2 inverse. This follows from a representation. Right? That if you take this particular combination, you can see that I have taken it in order where it's not identity. Okay. So you use this identity and then compare terms of order on both sides. Okay, and what we'll find by doing this? Is I times I of TA doing this manipulation, you should be able to prove that. And then from there, it's a simple exercise. The second exercise is to show that this implies this relation over here. Okay, because TATB anti commutator on this side, we already know that it's IFBC, IFCB, CABDC. Okay, so the structure constants do not depend on what representation you have used. Okay, so once, of course, you have to normalize your TS, right? But once you have normalized TS, then in all representations, the structure constants take the same value. That's it, yeah. They characterize the algebra. Yeah. So they are more or less characterized the group as well. Other questions? Okay, so now we'll consider a slightly more general version of the theory that I've been considering, which is that what happens when you have multiple gauge loops. Okay. So far you have been assuming that you have maybe SUN, right? Maybe SON or some ECH group. But in general, we may have more than one gauge loop. Okay, which basically means the theory may be invariant under more than one kind of transformation. More than one kind of gauge transformation. So, in general, more than one gauge group is that you have a set of gauge groups which are called G1, G2, G3. There will be separate fields or separate gauge fields for each of them and separate gauge transformations for each of these. So what we'll do here is that for each of these gauge groups, we'll introduce a set of gauge fields. So for G1, we will take U on mu, where this index A will run from 1 to N1. Okay, N1 is the number of generators of G1. This is the number of TS, number of generators. At this level, okay, you can take these two abstract objects, okay, yes, or if you don't like abstract objects, you choose particular representation for each of the gauge groups, okay, and use that representation to define, manipulate whatever you are doing. Okay, just imagine that for each gauge group, we have chosen some representation, okay, so that we actually have matrix representation for the generators. Okay, so similarly, you have B2 mu A. A running from 1 to N2 and so on. So we define SI nu as PA DI nu. As I said, you can think of these as abstract objects, TS, okay, or you pick some particular representation and call them TS.
These should also have some limits.
Yes, defined groups, thank you. So this, these should have some I index. It doesn't make sense to have the same T for all gauge groups. Okay? So TIA.
Sir, these groups can be anything, not SQL.
There can be?
Any group, not
SQL,
limited to
SQL. Yes, it's not limited to SQL. Right? Because I have already told you how to deal with a general group. Right? Just pick any representation and whatever you need, we do for that representation. Okay? So these groups can be anything. Okay? So the only difference, that suppose you pick a unitary representation, right? I mean the difference from SUN, okay, is that for SUN what we did is that we take to the set of all Hermitian matrices and introduce a gauge field for those. Right? If you are taking some say n dimensional representation, we take all n by n Hermitian matrices, Hermitian traceless matrices, and introduce generator. Right? For a general gauge group, okay, suppose you have taken an n dimensional unitary representation. Okay? Then the difference is that now not all Hermitian matrices will be generators. Right? Suppose you take some SUN and take a very big representation. Right? The number of generators doesn't depend on the dimension of the representation. Right? That's abstractly given by how many elements that algebra has, okay, or how many parameters does a group have. Right? So what will happen in this case is that not all M by M Hermitian matrices would correspond to generators of SUN, but a subset of them. Okay, they have to be still Hermitian because this is a unitary representation. Right? One of the representation is hermeticity of the generators followed from unitarity of the representation. Right? If you remember, the U dagger U equal to identity, right, told us that TA should be Hermitian. Right? Mm. By the same argument, if you take R of U dagger R of U as identity, okay, that will tell us that corresponding RA of TA should be Hermitian. But not all Hermitian matrices are included in RA. So that's the only difference from the SUN case. Okay, so pick any representation, you identify what are the generators of the group in that representation, and then work with those. Okay, rest of the analysis is exactly identical. Is this clear? Okay, because we have never really used anywhere that we are using SUN, right? If you actually examine what you have done, I mean, the only place where you have used SUN perhaps is that when you set the TATB commutator, okay, must be a linear combination of RMF TS, right? Because the TS formed a set of all Hermitian generators. Okay? Now, that's a defining property of the group, right? That otherwise it's not a group. If R of TA and R of TB commutator you take, and if you find that it's not a linear combination of some R of TC, then it's not a group. Okay? So, once you know that you have a group, this property is automatic. Even though you are not including all possible Hermitian matrices in the list. Okay. So right now these G's can be any group. Is this okay? Okay, so you define these for every group. Similarly, we define G I nu nu exactly in the same way for every group. So given this, now we can write down the gauge field kinetic term as trace. Okay, now let me, okay, I can still on it. So I can take the kinetic term as minus 1 over 2 gi square trace of gi nu nu gi nu nu. And then I sum over I. Because I want a kinetic term for every gauge group. Every gauge group, instead of gauge groups. because there are, these are all different fields, right? I want a quadratic term for each of those fields. Okay, so I have to sum over I. Oh yes, thank you. Is this clear? Okay. So the only new feature here that we see is that we can introduce one coupling constant for every gauge group. Okay. These GIs can be arbitrary. Okay. Not all GIs have to be the same. Okay. And each term here in this sum is individually gauge invariant. Right? Because what is a gauge transformation now? Okay. Maybe I should have said that. So gauge transformation. Now, it will be labeled by ui, u1, u2, up to uk. Okay. One transformation for every group. Okay. The ur is an arbitrary element. So, this belongs to the group g1, this belongs to the group g2, and so on. Okay. And the transformation law is the s prime I mu. Is given by minus I del mu ui ui inverse plus ui si mu ui inverse. Okay, so under a given ui, okay, only the corresponding gauge field bi mu transforms, right, or equivalent to si mu transforms. Okay. All the other gauge fields are neutral, okay, do not transform under ui. Okay. So suppose you want to make a transformation by u1 and not any of the other u's, set all of them, the rest to identity. Okay. That will act only on the gauge fields v1, okay, leaving v2, v3 and everything else unchanged. Is this okay? But now, every field, take a field psi. Okay, formula or boson doesn't matter. Okay. Earlier it was transforming in some representation of the gauge group. Right? But now you have to say how it transforms under every one of these gauge groups. Right? So it will have to transform in some representation of each of these k groups. Which means that this field psi will now have to carry k index, k labels. Okay. Besides the spiral index or the vector index that it may carry. Okay. If it's a Dirac formula, for example, it also has the Dirac spiral index, which you are not even writing. Okay. But it will have the structure that it will have an index I1 to IK. And these indices keep track of how it transforms under the gauge transformation. Okay. So the general transformation law will be the following, that psi prime I1 to IK will have the structure of R1 of U1, I1 J1, R2 of U2.
The which
lesson J1 is the sum of what?
What are the
indices? Yeah. So, I1, I2 up to ik, right? I1 runs over the set of values, okay, which is the dimension of the representation R1 of the first group of G1. Yeah. See, each group has its representations, yeah, right? Yeah. So, you pick one representation of each group, okay? So, given a field psi, it carries some representation of every group, right? I am saying that it carries a representation R1 of the group G1, okay, representation R2 of the group G2, representation R3 of the group G3, and so on. Is that clear? Okay. So because it carries representation R1 of the group G1, okay, the way the U1 transformation acts should be up through R1, I1, J1, okay, multiplying the corresponding index J1 of psi. Okay. But at the same time, these will also act. These will act on the second index of psi. Okay, that's the way I have introduced the index structure. Okay, so this k index indices of psi, okay, keep track of how these various representations, various transformations are acting on psi. Is this clear? Okay. So in particular, you can imagine that we want to transform by only one group element. Suppose you want to pick identity for the rest, okay, but and only U1, okay. So suppose you want to transform by U1. So if you want to transform just by U1, then all of these are identity. These matrices are identity matrices, right? Because U2 is identity now, right? U3 is identity. So this transformation becomes simply R1, I1, J1 of U1, then psi, J1, and rest are I2, I3 of I2. Okay, so the first group element transforms only the first index. Okay, rest of the indices are not touched. Similarly, second group element acts on the second index, and so on. So is this structure clear? Okay, because this is the most generic situation, that generically if you have a set of gauge groups and you have a set of fields, each field transforms in some irreducible representation of each gauge group. Now, sometimes it may happen that it doesn't transform under certain gauge groups. Okay. That case is also covered by this. Okay. When you say it doesn't transform under certain gauge groups, that means it transforms in the singlet representation. Right? Every group has one representation which is just multiplication by one. Okay. So, if it doesn't transform by gauge group, that means it transforms in the singlet gauge group, singlet representation. Okay. So, singlet representation means the corresponding index will take only one value. Right? Singlet representation is one dimensional, right? Okay, I mean if you have not learned representation, but at least singlet representation means that all the matrices just get mapped to one. Okay, that's a trivial representation, right? That always satisfies the group representation properties. So all the matrices get mapped to one. So the singlet representation, okay, for which this the corresponding index will take only one value. Okay? So then you may just choose to drop it. If it just takes one value, then nothing is happening to that index, right? So it's not that you always write if you have k groups, right? You don't always write k indices, okay? But and that's because sometimes what may happen is that under some of the groups it doesn't transform, you just drop that index, okay? But this is the most general way of writing how a field should transform.
Electron doesn't transform.
Exactly, it's an electron in standard model doesn't transform under SU3. So you don't write an index for electrons, the SU3 index. But you could have written an index and allowed it to take only one value. Right? That will be perfectly consistent with this notation.
So what does the indices at R, I1, J1?
Yes.
R1 is a matrix.
R1 is a matrix.
So R1, I1,
J1
is still a matrix.
No. This is an index. This is a number. R1 is a matrix. I1, J1 means that it is the I1, J1 component of R1. See, earlier I was writing psi goes to R of u times psi, right? Now there are many matrices, right? So you have to say which matrix is acting on which index. So I have just make all the indices explicitly. In this notation, the earlier transformation would have been psi I goes to R A I J of u times psi. Right? I have just now I have to write all the indices, because unless I write all the indices, it will not be clear which is acting on what
index. A is not there.
Pardon?
A is for algebra.
Yeah. Alright. Okay, so that's the only difference from the previous notation, right? Earlier I was not writing the index. And in all of this, I have not included any Lorentz index that it may carry. Right? If it's a spinner, it will carry also the alpha index, right? That alpha index will be the same on both sides.
So when you use the compact notation, you have to remove the I1.
Yes, but the point is, in this case, it's hard to write a compact notation, right? Because then when you write R times R, right? I mean, this is not a matrix multiplication, right? So it's, in this case, it's best to write all the indices explicitly. I mean, otherwise you have to write a multi-dimensional matrix multiplication, right? The different matrices are in different dimensions.
Maybe just some tensor product notation.
Yeah, you can do tensor product notation, but I mean, you write tensor product here, but yes, then you have to make sure that this is transforming in an appropriate representation of the tensor product representation. But it doesn't matter. I mean, writing indices is not always bad. Right? You might have to write the index explicitly. Okay, so now, in order to write the kinetic term for psi, okay, or in fact any term that involves derivative of psi, we have to introduce a covariant derivative. Okay? Even for a single gauge group, we have to introduce covariant derivative. So obviously here you have to introduce a covariant derivative. Okay? So the question is, what is the definition of b mu psi, which of course has index psi 1 to ij. Earlier I didn't write the index explicitly, but now I'll have to write the index. So the first term is easy to guess. It says del mu psi I1 to I. So what is the next term? Well, let's write one by one, right? I'm not trying to writing sum over I in this case will be complicated. So what is the next term? It has to couple to the first gauge field, right?
B I 1 J 1
psi J 1. Yes, so B. Well, let's use S. S. S1. Okay? Let's do S1. So how does it couple to S1? Let me remind you that D mu psi, the definition that I have given, was del mu psi minus I S mu psi, right? This was the matrix notation that I have given. So using this, you have to guess how it, what is the coupling?
S1, I1, J1,
psi, J1, I2. Okay, minus I. Okay. S1 of I1, J1. Okay. So the I1 index has to be carried by S1, because if you think of this, right? If you take d mu psi I, right? This is S mu I j psi j. Right? So I index has to be carried by S, right? So that's why it's S1 of I1, J1. And then?
Psi,
J1,
I2 to I3.
Psi, J1, I2 to I3. Okay, I2 to I3 are unchanged. Now you can guess what the next term will be, right? So that's minus I, S2, Now I2 J2 psi I1, the first index is not changing. Then you have J2 I3 to I2 and so on. Okay, so this is the way you have to define covariant derivative. Is this clear? Okay, now what is the property of this covariant derivative? So what is this object, d mu prime psi prime of I1 to I2? What property do you want for this?
One, two.
Yeah, so it's basically this one, right? The same matrix multiplying the d mu psi. So we want this to be R1 I1 J1 of U1, R2 of I2 J2 of U2. I'll leave it as an exercise to verify this. Okay, everything that you need is explicitly given, right? The mu psi definition has been given. So basically what will happen is that when you calculate del mu of this, or del mu of psi prime, you will find that there are, of course, there is one term where del mu acts on this, but there are various other terms where del mu acts in turn on this one, then on this one, then the next one, and so on, right? There are k unwanted terms, right? What del mu acts on this matrices, and those k unwanted terms must get cancelled by the corresponding transformation laws of the S's. Okay? The S's also have this del mu universe kind of term. Those should cancel it, right? So that's what you have to kind of verify. And once you know how to calculate the covariant derivative, you can write down the kinetic term for psi. Okay? Just replace del mu by d mu. And you can also calculate all possible couplings between these fields. Okay, suppose you have to write down general interaction terms in the action, right? By coupling these various fields. Okay. So what you have to make sure is that for each gauge group, okay, you couple them to a singlet. Because you want the terms to be invariant under each of the k gauge groups, right? So when you take, say, three fields, right? Psi 1, psi 2, psi 3. Psi 1 is carrying a set of gauge indices. Right, k gauge indices, psi 2 is carrying a set of k gauge indices, psi 3 is carrying a set of k gauge indices. Okay. You have to make sure that those three get contracted. For each of the groups, they are contracted by an appropriate Clebsch-Gordan coefficient so that they give singlets. Okay, they are gauge invariant. So this way you can ensure that the Lagrangian or the action that you are writing is invariant under each of these k gauge groups. No, the Clebsch-Gordan, yeah, you get a product of Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, but actually it's not just a Clebsch-Gordan, because yesterday itself we saw that there are product of two Clebsch-Gordan coefficients one by one, right, for cubic coupling. Okay, so for each gauge group you will have various possibilities, right, and then you have to combine those possibilities for different gauge groups, right. Suppose for first gauge group you combine it in three different ways, right, the second one you combine it in two different ways, then in the product, you can combine it in six different ways, right? You can take any of those three combinations of the first gauge group, or any of the two of the second gauge group, right? Or any of the, say, five from the third gauge group, and so on. Okay, so you basically have to make sure that all gauge indices are appropriately contracted so that you get gauge invariant.
When I'm writing for different cases in this transformation of d mu, so psi's are different representations of the groups, I mean R1,
exactly.
R2.
Yes.
So this will be also RA1 of this one, like that?
Yeah, this is R1 I have written.
No, in the d mu.
Oh, yeah, you are right, thank you. So I should have written this. If not. Otherwise, of course, this contracting index itself doesn't make sense, right? Because the dimensions have to match. Right? So it better be RA, the same representation that I have used there, that is what you have to use. Right? And this is R2.
If all the all the representations are of same dimensions, so then it this form is exactly identical to the transformation covariant derivative of a k rank tensor where r I r a and s v, these are identified with the Christoffel symbols.
Yeah, except that these things are still different. Mm-hmm. Even if all the representations are of the same dimension,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
These are different gauge fields.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. You are not identifying gauge fields to themselves,
okay.
right? So it's still different from having a rank k tensor.
Okay.
Okay, so this is as much as I'll say about the classical gauge theories. Okay, this is the general construction. Now I'll start discussing perturbation theory. Okay. How to quantize gauge theories and write down Feynman diagrams. So here, for simplicity, consider a single gauge. If you want to understand this case, you can easily generalize it to multiple gauge tubes. And we take trace TATB to be half the entire. Okay, or if you have used some representation R to write down the kinetic term, trace of RA of TA, RA of TB to be half delta. Okay, whatever representation you have used for writing the kinetic term, I will normalize it to half. So in this case, the gauge kinetic term, gauge field kinetic term, this is given by minus 1 over 4 g square integral g for x j g a g a mu nu, let me write down the expression again. Now, recall that FABC is totally antisymmetric. Okay, once we have this normalization, okay, as we discussed earlier, FABC becomes totally antisymmetric. Okay, so I don't have to worry about whether these are contract to the first two or the last one. This is, as I have written, this is fine. Okay, otherwise it could have been APCA. Okay, the last index would have gone, the first index would have gone there. So now we want to get rid of this 1 over g. And the way we get rid of this 1 over g is by introducing a new field.
Introduce new field
in U n such that
g nu n is g times.
Then gm u nu becomes g times fm u nu. Let me write what it is. Like fm u nu is this clear? Right? Because you see g, g mu gets replaced by g times mu, right? That g I have taken out. This gets replaced by g times mu. But here you have g squared times mu, mu, right? So one g is left over and that's this. And the kinetic term, let me call this k. Kinetic term now takes a form minus 1 to 100 . This is okay? I just read. Now you see that this G appears always in cubic and higher order terms. Right? If you expand this out, the quadratic term is independent of G. The cubic term, which comes from the product of these, has a G. Or this also has a G. And the quartic term, which has four A's, is G squared. So the way we develop perturbation theory is by thinking of G as a small parameter and then doing an perturbation expansion in G. And this in fact is true not only for the gauge field self interaction, but in all couplings of the fermions or scalars to the gauge field, right? We replace d mu by d mu plus something which involves d mu, right? Or del mu plus d mu. And that d mu now carries with a g. Once you replace d in terms of a, it will carry a g. Okay. So couplings of the gauge field to fermions will be accompanied by this power of g. Okay. So even when you expand the fermionic action or the scalar action, you will find that the free part doesn't have any g. Okay. And all the other parts, like the interactions that will involve fermions and gauge fields or scalars and gauge fields, those will all carry powers of g. Okay. So it, from this perspective, it's natural to take g as a small parameter and do a perturbation expansion. So the leading order term is as the quadratic part of the action. And there we have seen how to deal with the path integral, right? The free part we treat by treating the quadratic part of the action. And then everything else we dump into interactions. Now if you have multiple gauge groups, then there is a coupling constant for each gauge group. And now, when you do this scaling for each of these gauge groups, we have not one coupling constant, but we have multiple coupling constants. Right? And we treat all of them to be small and carry out perturbation expansion in all of them. So when you, now when you say that we want order up to certain order in perturbation theory, right? We have to say up to which order and which coupling constant. Right? It doesn't make sense to say that you want to go up to third order in perturbation theory. Without specifying third order in what coupling constant. Right? You may choose to go third order in all coupling constants, but that's something that you have to specify. For example, in the case of standard model, right, the strong interaction is strong. Okay, so there you really have to go very high order in perturbation theory. Weak interaction, electromagnetic interaction, you can stop after a few orders. Okay. So that's something that is dictated by what the experimental values of the coupling constants are. As to which coupling constant should be treated how. Is this clear? Okay, so you have to keep in mind that there are multiple coupling constants in the theory. Okay. There can in fact be even more coupling constants because, for example, it introduces cubic couplings, right? Which are not directly related to the gauge, the G, right? We introduce a 5-5-5 coupling, right? By using the Clebsgordan coefficients. The corresponding coefficient in front of that term is also an arbitrary number. And when you do perturbation theory, you take that number also to be small. Okay, all cubic and higher order couplings you take to be small and you expand in perturbation series. Okay. But these are all different expansions, right? That's what you have to keep in mind.
In case of when we form the interactions by forming gauge singlets, those coupling constants will in general be dimensionful, right? Like here we have dimensionless.
They are okay. If you use cubic coupling of the scalars, they will be dimensionful. But you can have quadratic couplings of the scalars,
yes,
which will be dimensionless.
Means, what I was asking is that means, can you do a perturbation theory with some dimensionful?
Yes, you can do perturbation theory with dimensionful coupling constants also.
You
have
to specify some scale that in that.
Exactly. So it will look, when you do a perturbation expansion, you will find that that dimensionful coupling constant will always come in the combination of G over some energy. Yeah, that's the perturbation theory. But it will automatically happen. Questions? Okay, so let's then start with the simplest part, okay, the free part, the quadratic part. So the quadratic part is -1 quadrat. So this is the same as the Maxwell action. For each A, this is exactly what Maxwell's action had, right? So as far as if you just look at the quadratic part, if you switch off the gauge couplings, then this theory is indistinguishable from just k copies of Maxwell's axis. Where k is the total number of generators of the gauge. Okay, so for each generator, you have a Maxwell axis. But this, of course, we have already seen earlier, is problematic. Right? It is problematic because this doesn't allow you to invert the kinetic term. Right? The corresponding matrix is non-invertible. And the same problem will appear here as well. And the reason for this is also the same. So let's recall that the reason that the Maxwell action had this problem, okay, the reason that the kinetic term was not invertible, is because it had gauge invariance, okay, which meant that under certain deformations of the AMU, the action doesn't change. Right? And if the action doesn't change, then this doesn't change, right? Which means corresponding quadratic term must have a zero eigenvalue, It's exactly the same logic here, okay, but it's a little different. So let me say how this goes. So here you look at the linear transformation law. Now this is infinitesimal. Consider infinitesimal. So this was given by del mu epsilon A plus okay, again, I've shifted these indices around. Okay, earlier, there's a different construction, but I'm using total anti-symmetry away from this. So, given this delta mu A, we can easily read out, right? It's 1 over t times delta mu A. So, I'll write this as del mu epsilon tilde A plus F ABC plus G by epsilon tilde A is just 1 over T times epsilon. Yeah, I just converted this to epsilon tilde. So, 1 over t is already included in this, and this g came because b mu I replaced in terms of a mu. So, this gauge transformation is slightly different from what the Maxwell's theory had. There it was just del mu epsilon tilde, right? But you can see that in the g goes to 0 limit, it is exactly the same, right? So, the leading order term, okay, the quadratic term in the action, has a flat direction precisely because of gauge. Taking g goes to 0 because you are doing perturbation theory, right? Because to leading order in perturbation theory, this is the action and g goes to 0 limit. So to see the symmetry, you have to look at the transformation also in the g goes to 0 limit. So the origin of this problem is the same. So you expect that the resolution of should also be the same. Okay? So let's recall what the problem was physically. Right. We discussed this in the context of Maxwell, so let me describe this again. Okay. And it's useful to describe this pictorially. Okay. So let's suppose this is our field space. Field space. three configurations. Okay, which means all possible configurations of all possible fields. Okay, which is of course an infinite dimensional space. Okay, but you have to be satisfied with a two-dimensional picture. Okay. So, suppose the plane of the board is a field configuration space. And it has this property that along some of the directions, okay, start from any point, okay, which means this gives you a particular field configuration. You have specified all the fields and all the functions. Now, starting from any point, if you make this gauge transformation in some epsilon, okay, or you make a finite gauge transformation, okay, this is of course infinitesimal, but there is a finite version of this, right? Take a finite version of the gauge transformation and transform this. So what this is going to do is to take this to another point, right? Because you have a different field configuration, and you do this and so on. So it describes what is called a gauge orbit. Is this clear? This is called gauge orbit. Now both the direction transverse to this as well as the direction tangential to this are infinite dimensional, right? Because this epsilon A itself has infinite number of parameters, infinite a set of functions, right? You have to specify. So obviously each function itself has infinite number of parameters. But roughly this is a picture. Okay, the configuration space is what is called foliated. Okay, given any configuration, you can draw a subspace of the full configuration space, such that all points on the subspace are related to each other by gauge transformation. Is this clear? So what is the property of this subspace? The property of the subspace is that the action is independent of where you are on the subspace. Right? That's the meaning of gauge invariance of the action. So when you take into the IS,
what does it mean by
the
closing?
Okay, I have drawn it closed. Okay, you could have drawn it open also. This depends on the details of the gauge loop. Okay. If you use compact gauge loop, right, you might think that it is closed because after you have made a sufficiently large gauge transformation, you have come back to the original. Right, that's how I have closed it. Okay, but in effect, it behaves as if it's not closed. Okay, I'll discuss this point in a few minutes. Okay. So you have this e to the is, okay? And what this is saying is that this e to the is, or if we use Euclidean formalism, right, e to the minus s, okay, whatever that is, that doesn't change as you move around this. Okay? So because of this, this object is divergent. D mu, d phi, the various other things are here. This is divergent. Simply because this doesn't get suppressed as you are integrating. Is this clear? Now here, this question of compactness comes in. You see, if this is really compact, then you would expect that, okay, so it shouldn't diverge. It should give some finite value, right? But the reason that you see this divergence in perturbation theory, you can, various ways to see this. First, if you see the natural parameter, when you use the variables a mu, okay, the natural parameters are epsilon tilde I. Okay, these are the original parameters. Okay. So what is finite is that when you lift these parameters into finite transformation, that range is finite. Then epsilon a, okay, this is of course infinitesimal, but you can consider a finite version of this. So in these variables, we expect a finite range. But epsilon tilde is 1 over g times epsilon. Okay. So when you do perturbation theory, g goes to 0. Okay. Then it's as if epsilon tilde takes value over infinite subspace, infinite dimensional space, right? Because even if it's a, suppose it was taking value, epsilon was taking value on a circle of finite size, right? Epsilon tilde will take value on a circle of infinite size. Right. So in perturbation theory, you don't have, you always have this issue, right? That the finiteness of the integration range you don't see. What is worse is that you have epsilon at every point. Right? So it's not just one infinite orbit. Okay, it gets multiplied by the, it gets raised to the power, okay, which is given by the number of points, right, which itself is infinite. Okay? So those are the infinities you see in this integral. Okay? So having compact gauge group doesn't really help as far as perturbation theory is concerned. But there are non-perturbative techniques, for example, when people use lattice gauge theories, right? In lattice gauge theories, you really use UN, okay? You don't necessarily do perturbation theory, okay? And you have finite number of points, okay? You put the whole thing on a lattice, or a finite size lattice. There actually you don't need to worry about this problem, okay? You find that both the numerator and the denominator are actually finite, okay? And eventually the ratio is also finite, okay? But in perturbation theory, you encountered this problem precisely because of this orbit.
So in that case, DMU, the measure will be something fine. So how?
DMU, so see, that measure you always factor out, okay? That is just some G, some part of G, but that just cancels, that's a constant factor that cancels for numerator and denominator. Okay, right? So this G, you don't see, right? What you see is that if you use this perturbation theory in this framework, that there are flat directions which extend over infinity, infinite range. That's, so in terms of mu variable, right? Mu variable is getting transformed by the epsilon tilde, right? And then epsilon tilde, if it takes infinite range, right, the corresponding mu, the flat direction in the mu space will also become infinite range. Okay, and it happens for every space standpoint. Okay, so what is the remedy? The remedy is, again, as we have seen in Maxwell's theory, namely that suppose we are calculating this is the kind of thing we want to calculate in using path integral, right? Correlation functions of operators. As long as these are gauge invariant, this infinite integral, okay, which is generated by the gauge transformation, factors out from the numerator and denominator, right? Because these are invariant, this is invariant, this is also invariant. So this infinite integral will simply factor out from the numerator and denominator. So this we expect to be finite after factoring out and this is what you would have done in your homework problem, right? In the Maxwell's theory, one of the problems was to explicitly evaluate correlation functions of F mu by factoring out this infinite integral, right? Keeping the integration of three variables instead of four. But this turns out to be difficult to implement for non-Abelian gauge theories, okay? Even in the case of Maxwell's theory, you will find that while it can be done, okay, it's a complicated procedure, okay? That you have to really try to change variables and factor out the gauge orbit, right? There the gauge transformation was linear, right? The del mu epsilon was all that we had, right? But here, of course, it's not linear, right? There are also higher order terms in the gauge transformation. Okay? So things become complicated here. So we proceed somewhat differently, but in philosophy, okay, this is what we want to do. Okay, we want to factor out the common factor for the numerator and denominator. But you have to do it in a more systematic procedure, right? Instead of having to actually change variables, right? You have to see if we can do it more systematically.
Sir,
one question. Yes. In Maxwell theory, they are actually means this procedure only works if one or two, those are only gauge invariant operators. So that's why you calculated a mu nu mu correlation function. But suppose means one want to calculate a mu a nu correlation function, that then cannot.
But that is not well defined. That is not yeah. a physical object.
Yeah, then one has to means fix a point on the gauge orbitant that represents the full gauge
orbit. Yeah, the result will depend on what point you are fixed.
Yeah, that is obviously.
Yeah, right. So if you want to think in terms of physical quantities, right, then all physical quantities can be calculated by this procedure.
Yeah,
this factorization procedure, right. If you want to calculate unphysical quantities, they cannot be calculated.
Yeah, but those actually appears in the propagators, right? So basically, those are the results what one
true.
Need to.
But calculate. For Maxwell's theory, right, you could calculate it without calculating the propagator. This exercise that I gave, mm-hmm. right, mm-hmm. you will find that you can actually calculate this two-point function, f mu nu, f rho sigma,
yeah,
without ever calculating the propagator.
Yeah, right? That's because those are the gauge invariant things.
Yes. So the point is, all the calculations in field theory that you would ever want to do, in principle, can be reformulated as in terms of gauge invariant calculations, gauge correlation functions of gauge invariant quantities. It doesn't always appear to be that,
yeah,
right? But in practice, it's only gauge invariant quantities that make sense, right? Yes, and all calculations that you normally do, right, you can trace back to showing that it actually calculates gauge invariant quantities.
But suppose one is calculating a means. Electron-electron going to electron-electron in QAD process.
Yes.
So then one have to put the propagator for the AMU-AMU, right, in this diagram. So then one needs
the
to
point is, we can in principle do without the propagator for AMU-AMU, but it requires much more work.
Yeah.
Right? So the point is, you have to simplify life, right, by doing something which is easier. But in principle, you should be able to do this using AMU-AMU. Right, that's the point. That I mean, ultimately, if you are interested only in gauge invariant quantities, right, it shouldn't. In lattice gauge theory, for example, right, if you have to calculate the same thing, you don't need to do any gauge fixing, right? You just cancel things from the numerator and denominator. You never define any AMU propagator there, right? In perturbation theory, it is useful to define something like an AMU propagator, because that's what you use normally, right? But I'm saying in principle, you can calculate everything in terms of gauge invariant quantities. Is that okay? Okay, so what we'll do, okay, is that instead of trying to factor it out, well, eventually, of course, we have to factor it out. What we'd like to do, okay, is that instead of worrying about this gauge orbit, you have, say, multiple gauge orbits. So this is one gauge orbit, this is an inequivalent gauge orbit, and there is another one like this. So from each gauge orbit, you want to pick one point. Okay? Because once you know the value at this point, the rest of the values are the same. Okay? So you want to pick one point from each gauge orbit. And then add other contribution. Right? Which in this case will correspond to drawing some curve like this. Wherever the curve hits, well, it's not actually a curve, it's again an infinite dimensional space, right? Because everything is infinite dimensional. In this two-dimensional language, it's like a curve passing through this plane. Okay? So, this curve will intersect these gauge orbits at different points. Okay? Instead of trying to integrate over the gauge orbits, we will simply integrate over this curve, okay, hoping that because it passes each gauge orbit once, okay, it picks up the right contribution. Is this principle clear? Okay. So you want to convert the integration over the plane, okay, into integration over this curve. But if we just do it naively, we will see that we get the wrong answer. Okay, so we have to really make sure that we do things correctly. Okay, but if we do things correctly, it is possible to write the original integral, which was an integral over this big space, okay, as integration over the subspace. Okay, which is a subspace of gauge inequivalent configurations. You cannot go from here to here by gauge transformation. Right? You can go from here to any other point on this by gauge transformation. So that will be the goal of this quantization of the perturbative quantization of gauge theories. That we pick one point from each gauge orbit and try to integrate over that direction.
So when we do this
subspace
integration, of
this fact that this curve, ultimately what curve I am taking, is would not depend if it intersects each orbit at one point. Then
well, you have to do a little more. It's not enough to just intersect each orbit at one point. We'll see that. We'll try to do something naively tomorrow. And we'll see that we run into difficulty. Like you have to actually do more than ensuring that it intersects each orbit at one point.
Why are these orbits separate?
Why are these
orbits separate, not intersecting each other?
Well, they are not intersecting each other because by definition, if they intersect, they are part of the same orbit. Right? See, imagine that this and this point. Suppose you have an orbit like this, right? Infinite number, because it's an infinite dimensional space, right? And the gauge group itself is infinite dimensional because you have an epsilon at every point, right? So the infinite dimensional space, okay, and infinite each orbit is also infinite dimensional, right? But it's just that after you have factored out the integration about the orbit, you are still left with an infinite dimensional integral. In the case of Maxwell's theory, right, you have this A mu, the four components to begin with, right? But then by changing variable, right, we reduced it into integration over three sets of fields in momentum space. Right, so it's still an infinite dimensional integral. Right, but you have reduced that problem by infinite dimensional infinite amount because you have removed one field altogether by
what
this
are
thing.
Points
each point here in this configuration space is a field configuration, right? Which means specifying every field at every point in space time.
So some field
exactly. So that's the orbit.
That means some other field configurations are not related, they're not connected.
That's it. They are not connected by gauge transformation. So a point here and a point here are not connected by gauge transformation.
But they are from the same gauge group.
No, these are not gauge, this is not a gauge group. These are configurations. So this is a field configuration, right? This involves the A mu and the psi's and the phi's. Right? Gauge transformation, the gauge group is a much smaller space, right? So the gauge transformations are acting on A mu. So when you go from here to here, for example, right? This is a transformation where you're going from A mu A, A mu prime A T A is, I think it has minus I, L mu U inverse plus U A mu A T A U inverse, right? So given any mu, suppose you are given a field configuration mu of x, right, which means specify all the functions mu of a as a function of x, right, then this transformation generates a new function, right? So original field configuration is a point in this configuration space. This is a new point in the configuration space, right? Those will lie on the same gauge orbit, right? But there are other mu's which are not related to the original mu by transformation like this. Those are outside this orbit. So the idea is that you take each configuration, okay, and associated with it is an orbit, okay, which is all the other configurations which are related by gauge transformation.
So if I was given two field configurations,
yes,
I know whether they are connected or not if I can find a U such that...
Exactly, that's right. So that's the idea. So two field configurations are connected if you can find a U which such that they are related by this. In fact, you also have to use for the corresponding psi, right? Psi prime is equal to U psi. You have to look at the collection of all the fields, right? And this collection of all the original fields must be related to the collection of all the new fields by this transformation for the same U. And so that's what you mean by this orbit.
So that means in the set of U's,
yes,
there are subsets.
There are?
In the set of U's, the correspond to each orbit, there is a set of
corresponding to each orbit, there's a whole set of U's, all the U's. Yes. So different U's generate different points on this orbit. Yeah? If you take a particular U, that corresponds to a particular point on this orbit, right? But U of X is a function worth degree of freedom, right? So there are lots of points on this orbit, okay, which are all generated by this defined choice. Okay, so this is what you want to factor out. That's the main goal.
Along this path, particular orbit, IS doesn't change because this is the symmetry of...
Exactly,
the
that's right.
So what divergence can you just repeat?
Because this integral now diverges, right? Because if nothing is changing, yeah, right, then the integral gives a divergent integral as a volume of this orbit.
Okay, that is infinite dimensional.
That is infinite dimensional, right?
Okay, so first we have to think that in path integral formalism, all the fields have different configurations. So this space is all the collection of all the configurations.
Yes.
At each point, all the fields are specified.
Exactly.
As a function of space time.
Exactly.
Now, given a specific configuration for set of fields, we are transforming the gauge transformation. So this is a particular orbit. Given another configurations for the fields, same gauge group gives another
exactly orbit. Exactly.
So a single gauge group we are considering.
Well, multiple gauge groups will also be of the same type, right?
Okay.
You just have to add, I mean, this will have more directions if you have multiple gauge groups. Right? But the general philosophy is the same, right? Take all the possible gauge symmetries, right? And they will generate orbits, right? Along those orbits, the integrand is not changing, right? So you just get the volume, which is infinite. Yeah, that's what you want to factor out. Yeah, unless you factor it out, the path integral diverges, as you have seen, right? That's the origin of this candidate term not being invertible.
And that is sure that you can factorize?
We'll see. We'll see. But if you can factorize, it's sure you can factorize if these are gauge invariant, right? If these are gauge invariant, then the integration over the gauge orbit, right, can be separated out from that S, because nothing here is depending on the on the points in the gauge orbit, right?
Okay, okay.
Only for gauge invariant objects that is factorized works, right? Otherwise, no. So that's the reason why in gauge theories, the only quantities which make sense are the correlation functions of gauge invariant quantities. Okay, otherwise, if you take mu, for example, right? In some gauge, you can define what mu and nu correlation function is, but that has no meaning.
Tomorrow,